Good morning, everyone. It's great to be in worship with you this beautiful Sunday morning. Would you please stand with us and let's come before the Lord, singing of his might, his greatness, and all that he's done for us. Let's join our voices and sing, sing, sing. We sing your praises this morning. We thank you for your amazing love, your amazing grace, and how you've blessed us, Lord. Help us to carry that love and that grace to others around us in these trying times. We give you praise for your example.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Gentleness and kindness, Lord, as we sang, you were willing to lay down your lives for us, Lord. Grant us that we would have that kind of compassion towards others. Jesus said that there's no greater love than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friend. And although few of us are called for such things, Lord, we pray that you would give us the courage to be willing to do such a sacrifice as you did for us. Help us to spread the love of Jesus Christ through all that we say, all that we do, all the actions that we take. I praise you for your example. 3 and 4. Sing of his gentleness.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Savior, Savior, hear my
Father God, thank you for the invitation this morning. Thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit who would call and invite and strengthen us to be right here, right now, enjoying your presence. Father God, thank you that you do not pass us by, but you walk beside us, you hold us, and you so often carry us through the most difficult things of life. This morning, please speak to us again your truth. Please share with us again your amazing grace. And please increase our joy that it might show on our very faces as we go forth from here to make much of you and to draw others to Jesus Christ alone. We pray it in his strong name. Amen. And brothers and sisters, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as all God's people say, amen. Please be seated. First of all, you may be wondering, why are the lights on up here, but why are the lights not on out there? Well, that's because through some complications with our electrical service over the course of the weekend, our air conditioning unit for the sanctuary went off. We were finally able to get it back on at about 7:30 this morning, but normally it takes about 3 hours to cool this space. So if you don't mind sitting in the dark and letting Jesus be your light, that's how we're going to proceed this morning. We also want to continue to keep you in prayer for Wayne and Linda Coster's grandson, Brody. We shared with you last week that he was found to have a brain tumor, and doctors did surgery this past week, over 12 hours of surgery. But doctors believe they are confident that they were able to remove the fullness of that tumor. Can you praise God for that answer? All ready to prayer. Now, there's going to be much therapy that follows for Brody, but let's continue to keep him in our prayers. We're also grateful this morning. Butch Hanges stopped me on his way into worship and shared that doctors are telling him regarding his cancer that it is in remission. Can we praise God again for that great news on behalf of Butch? There are many reasons for us to be in prayer and to remain in prayer. Remember, you can always find updates online, frchudsonville.org. But if you do have a question, if you have an additional need, then please go ahead and reach out to the church office. Contact one of us. We'll make sure that you have what you need, and we'll find answers to your questions. Let's turn together to God in prayer. Father, it is good that we may turn to you and immediately understand that your ear and your attention has remained in our direction. And we thank you and we praise you for this incredible relationship. Again, we're reminded that it is by the shed blood of Jesus Christ alone that our lives have been redeemed, that our lives have been reconciled, that we are in right relationship with you. And not only that, but you have filled our lives with the power of your Holy Spirit, and it is fruit that is being borne out. We thank you in advance that once again this morning, our pastor Brent is going to speak to us from your word regarding this same fruit of the Spirit. And Father God, we ask that the Spirit will continually help us to put this old life and this old flesh to death, and that the power of your Holy Spirit will do much in us and through us as we continue to live out the gospel of Christ in this world. And thank you that we not only live out the truth of the gospel right here, but we are in partnership living out the truth of the gospel in Liberia with Gift of Hope Christian Schools. We thank you for the opportunity to speak the truth into the lives of these young students, that they would not only have a worldview, but that they would have a Christian worldview, Father God, that understands from creation to redemption to eternity, everything falls under your authority. And may that be a message that we never grow tired of making much of. Father, I thank you this past week for the junior high youth group and for the spiritual adventure that they were able to be on, for the lessons that were learned, for the trips that were taken, even for the service that they did outside here around the church, caring and being stewards for your house. I thank you for their lives and for the way that they continue to live for Christ. And now this week, praying for those students in high school who are going to do the very same. Thank you for all of the volunteers. Thank you for Brian Boom and for J.D. Dyer and for their commitment in making disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we come before you this morning, and it's with thanksgiving that we're able to praise you for the good news that Brody and Butch have both received. Thank you for healing already received. But Father, we trust you for every day of our lives. We continue now to bring before you others, praying for your will to be done, for Barb and the surgery, for Don, who is still waiting for some results and answers, for Cal, that his health will remain strong as those stem cells are again harvested. For Sue, as she has heard, leukemia, Father God, a recurrence. And we thank you that you continue to hold her, even as we prayed earlier, and that you even carry her through this challenging time. We pray for Deb Hinkle, asking that you'll be with her as we try to figure out how to move forward with surgery. And for Mel, we ask that you'll continue to restore his vision fully. For Deb, as treatments now proceed, and for Stephanie, as she's non-weight-bearing for a time, thank you that both of those procedures went well for her. For Harold and the health of his heart, for Barb as she recovers now at home, and for Rocky praying effectiveness upon those injections, that the pain in his back would be brought under control. And Father God, finally, thank you that at just the right time you called Ari Vanderhyde home, that he was able to hear those words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Now enter into your eternal reward." Father, may that be a testimony that we are all able to share with our families, that they need not worry when we pass from this world to your everlasting presence. Towards that end, help us all to trust in Jesus. And Father, thank you that we may bring it all before you in his strong name, as all God's people say, amen. Vicki with our children's message.
Okay, boys and girls, it is your turn. Are you ready? One, two, three. Oh my goodness, I'm still training the adults. Let's try this again. One, two, three. Some of you are learning. It's taking a while. Have you ever held a kitten or a puppy and like squeezed them in your arms and somebody said, "Gently, gently, don't hurt that kitten," or rubbed a baby's head and your mom or your dad said, "You need to be gentle when you touch a baby"? Well, we are still talking about the fruit of the Spirit, and one of those is gentleness. And the Bible tells us that we need to treat others, not just animals, not just the world, but other people with gentleness. We need to be gentle in what we do, not hitting or pushing or kicking or being mean. We have to be gentle. And we also have to be gentle in what we say. Do you know that when you say mean things to other people, it's like giving them bruises? It hurts them. And we need to be gentle. The Bible asks us to be gentle. So this week, when somebody says something mean to you, I want you to find a way to gently reply to them and show them how gentleness is one of the fruits of the Spirit, something that God wants us to do in the way that we act, the things that we do, and the things that we say. So that's your challenge for this week. Try to show gentleness to the people who are around you. Let's pray together. Dear Jesus, we thank you that we can come into your house and worship you. And we thank you that you have given us a Bible, and the Bible gives us direction on what we should be doing to follow you. And I thank you that gentleness is something that you are asking of us. Help us to find a way to show gentleness, to be gentle with the people who we meet this week. And all God's children said, amen.
Thank you. Please open up your Bibles to Galatians chapter 5. If you've been with us the last several weeks, you know that we've been camping out here. Hopefully we have parts of it memorized, right? Some of us do. Repetition, 7 weeks in a row, we can memorize things, right? Is anybody listening? No? What series are we in? Thank you. Did the fruits up here give you a tip? Excuse me, I'm just writing down a note here for myself. We are in Galatians 5. We're going to be looking at verses 16 through 26. If you notice, in verses 22 and 23, that is where we are. We see all of the fruits of the Spirit highlighted for us. We recognize that in verses 22 and 23, there is a distinctive break in some of the fruits. And today, we're going to be looking at the first one, which is gentleness. And I'm going to be totally transparent with you. Gentleness is something that I knew zero about before 2 weeks ago. And in fact, I want to make a blanket assumption that the majority of people who call themselves followers of Jesus Christ share the exact same stance. We think of the word gentleness, and immediately our minds go on places like that baby in a manger, meek and mild. Some of us refer to gentleness as maybe a little bit afraid. Some of us would go as far as saying, if we are gentle, if we are practicing gentleness, then we are toying with the idea of being labeled or being considered cowardly. Maybe that's because we don't know what gentleness is. In fact, one of the greats of the Christian faith, back in 1839, a teacher of the faith says this, and excuse his English, but I'm going to read it as best as I can. Perhaps no grace is less prayed for or less cultivated within the Christian community than gentleness. Indeed, it is considered rather as a belonging to natural disposition or external manners than as a Christian virtue. And seldom does the church reflect that not to be gentle is sin. If this statement is true from 1839, from a teacher of the faith named George Bethune, why would it be different for us today? So I'm asking, after I share the honest truth, outside of a petition before God prior to an important conversation that I have to have, but I am not looking forward to be a part of. Or before a meeting that, well, I'm not prepared for. Or a decision that I know needs to be made, but I'm not ready to make it. Outside of a plea, prior to a situation like that, asking God, give me the words to say, help me speak gentle, help me speak kind, help me be caring. I have never once asked God to give me gentleness. And if Pastor Buffoon is right, most of you have not either. Because we don't know what it is. We don't recognize it. We're scared of it. And friends, I believe that as we have the fruit of the Spirit artery within us when we call upon the name of Jesus Christ, that is my great prayer as I pray over the pews this week, that each and every one of us sees gentleness, recognizing where gentleness is supposed to be used in your life today. So, with our word open before us, I'm going to ask you to please stand where you are as we pray over these words. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, every man, woman, and child in this room today, or perhaps watching on television, is holding your truth in their hands and in their heart. So, Lord, thank you for what you're going to do through the opening of our eyes, the opening of our ears, the softening of our hearts, as you help us become more like your Son, Jesus Christ, today. May you alone receive all the glory and honor of lives that are transformed, not only in Fellowship Reformed Church, but in every Christian church in this world that teaches the only truth this world has ever known. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. Please be seated. As I mentioned a moment ago, we're going to begin at verse 16. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh, for the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to one another to keep you from doing the things that you want to do. Verse 18. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things of these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. What is it, friends? And self-control. Against these things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ, this is the only truth this world has ever known. Amen? So let's look at the reality of not knowing gentleness. In the first two texts here, it makes it very clear that you and me, we are in a moment-by-moment battle with what we're going to look at, with what we're going to do with our hands, where we're going to let our hearts go, who we're going to participate with and in. But I necessarily don't want to refer to those decisions today. The conversation, I want to go much deeper than decisions we make. Decisions you're making right now, are you going to begin checking me out? Decisions that are going to make you think to yourself, I need to engage into this sanctuary right now because I know it's not that pleasant of a conversation to have a what we're going to call today a spiritual MRI. For those of you in the back, I can't even see your faces. You can fall asleep and I'll never know. It's warm, it'll be probably easy. Do you want to know what gentleness is? I briefly explained what gentleness is not. And again, that is the idea that a man or a woman is sometimes referred to as a doormat. Right? Women, sometimes we think that if we are kind over and over and over again to our husband, if we are that person that is going to serve and get nothing back in response, we are being gentle and that person is walking over us. I understand that's not just for wives or women. I know that there are men today that see the word gentle and they think and they refer to themselves or they refer to a friend as a doormat or a pushover or someone who is not strong, someone who is not committed to the faith. That is what gentleness is not. What is gentleness in the biblical sense? I'm going to get there, but I want to share a story. For some of us, we've missed this summer, yes? And for some of us, this past week, we just found out that, yeah, it's going to be a shortened season, but we're going to be able to watch this ball bounce off the bats and outfielders make some great digs and pitchers throw no-hitters. We're going to watch the Tigers win 3 games in this hyphenated season. We're looking forward to the October. In my opinion, there's not a better sport to watch in all array than watching the postseason in October. We also heard some news. The Wolverines are playing. That's awesome. You get a clap for that, but you never get a clap when you tell them that Jesus loves you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Wolverines are coming back, right? That means the Spartans are too. They're going to play each other, right? All conference games, that's it, but they're going to play each other. This is a man's game, is it not? I know there's a lot of sports and a lot of activities that take every ounce of grit and blood and determination to hone your craft and to excel in it, to be good. To do what God has blessed you with the talents and the skills provided. I know there's lots of them, but for whatever reason, football has been labeled the kings of the school in high school, yes? The boys of the fall. We love to watch the helmets crash like rams on a mountainside. We love to hear the coaches yelling from the sidelines, shouting out calls. You know, in my opinion, there's not a better football movie ever made than what we call Remember the Titans. Remember that movie? Very quickly, if you haven't watched that before, it takes place in the middle of the segregation hive. There's a first year where they're going to put the black students and the white students together, not only in the same classroom, not only on the same school bus, but on the same football team. First time ever. And they hire a brand new coach who is also African-American. Coach Boone's his name, and he walks into this hornet's nest. of racism, and judgmentalism. And he knows that he's got a responsibility of teaching these young men what it means to be a man. Teaching these young men how to give it their best for the glory of God. How to look at another man and not for a second think of the pigmentation of their skin. Coach Boone was just short of getting run out of his home. People didn't like the idea of him coaching the white football team, the black football team. There's so many incredible, incredible stories within this story. But specifically, when he's talking about football and he's talking to his players, he makes this statement. Football is about controlling the anger, harnessing that aggression and emotion into a team effort to achieve the goal. I want to say that one more time. Football is about controlling that anger, harnessing that emotion and aggression into a team effort to achieve the goal. That is the key principle in this fruit. Let's go back to the first couple of verses in our text on 17 and 18. When we don't control our anger, when we don't control our passions, when we don't control the things of this world, what are we involved in? What is the Apostle Paul saying? We are involved in sexual immorality. Really? Impurity. Sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries. We're engaging in them daily when we're living outside of this fruit. A few moments ago, I said it's going to go deep, quick, and here we are. I'm asking you, like I've had to ask myself this past week, do you need an MRI? We are called to be perfect in everything, right? But we know because of sin, we cannot. Coach Boone also says, I don't expect you to be perfect, but I expect you to have a perfect attitude. You want to play on my football team, Coach Boone? I need you to have a perfect attitude. Members and friends of Fellowship Reformed Church, do you want a perfect attitude? We know that we fall short of the glory of God. That's why Jesus Christ came to begin with, yes? But he's calling us to have a perfect attitude. To seek the things that we already have because of what Christ has done for us. Do you want gentleness? I do. I can't tell you how many times I've had to drag my hind into Sarah and say, I am sorry for being such a tool. My kids would run out of ink if they had to write down the date of every time I had to go to them because I was responding or I snapped in an ungentle way. so many times I have sucked at being a dad or a husband. I am sure there's some in here that share that same thought. Do you want to be gentle dads? Yes or no? Moms, wives, do you want to be gentle? Yes or no? How do we do it? Next week, Pastor Sean is going to be talking about self-control and marrying self-control with gentleness. They cannot be separated. We cannot separate the desire to be gentle, to have an idea or a passion or a pursuit of having self-control. It cannot be separated. So how do we do it? How do we begin to have that mindset or that mentality of being gentle? Well, let's go back to our text, because our text cannot be wrong. Crucifying the flesh. Think about the instances in your life when you are not gentle. Perhaps it's at work. Perhaps it's in a conversation. Perhaps it's with a family member that you just don't see eye to eye with. Perhaps it's that young punk kid who just cut you off on the highway. Or better yet, you weren't even on the highway. You were on Kelly Street right by Gemmons, and you were going the speed limit, and they went 55 in front of you. Are you gentle? Just dropping my son off to the middle school youth group at Kellen and Lacey's house, knowing I'm preaching on this, and there is a runner, and I apparently did something he didn't like, and he gave me the bird, and I thought to myself, Brent, gentleness, gentleness. Harvest that anger, harvest that frustration, and let it go. Do we want to do that? Coach Boone says, release that anger, release that aggression, release that passion when the time is right. One of the greatest examples we have in the New Testament is found in pretty much half of the New Testament. A man named Saul, right? Some of you know who he is. Some of you have studied him. That's great. Saul, this zealous, this passionate, this man who was on fire for standing up for what he thought was right. He held nothing back. He woke up in the morning with the desire to do one thing, remove everything that has to do with being a follower of Jesus Christ, removing it from the planet forever for good, killing, burning, destroying. Not gentle, right? Right? But passionate, committed, faithful to what he thought was right. That was Saul. And we find out years later, after his watching one of Jesus' own disciples, Stephen, being stoned to death, Saul was there. His men were in charge of that execution. Saul, knowing that I have how many scalps to my name? I'm the big time here. He meets Jesus. Right? We call it the road to Damascus transformation. Meets Jesus, spends 3 years with Jesus, and digging deep into the reality of life and death, digging into the reality of Jesus Christ, came for him, Saul, which he self-proclaimed, the worst sinner of them all. My hands have more blood on it than any other human being. And then what does Jesus do? Change his name, Paul. Paul then goes out and starts the greatest church movement in the history of the world. We are here today because of that transformation of Saul to Paul. The Christian community knows who Paul is. They know who Saul is. He has a reputation. He's dangerous. He sees you. He knows where you are. You are dead. The Christian church knows that. But yet, in a Roman jail, writing a letter to a church that he started in Colossae, what does he say to his new converts in the faith of Jesus Christ? What does Paul say? When he's talking to them about the struggles of this life, the temptations of even within the church to go aside to the bonds of marriage, to lie, to cheat, to worship more than one God, to eat food that is not kosher. The internal demographics and the pollution of that day within the church, Paul says, hey, am I coming to you with whip and chain? Church of Jesus Christ, am I coming to you with whip and chain to cause you harm? No, I am coming to you with grace and love that comes from only Christ Jesus. If a man who is so hard and so broken, and definitely some men would say, this is a man that has passion and has vigor in his bones to do life. That's Paul, yes? Nothing was going to stop Paul, not a shipwreck, not a stoning, not a mob of angry, angry people. But yet he harnesses the aggression and he harnesses his emotion and his passion. And so delicately within the epistles he writes, I have come in grace and hope and love to help you, church, be the church God has called you to be. Not walking into a room and barking out orders. Not walking into a room and saying, come on, I've explained this to you for years and you still don't get it, do you? Are you ever going to amount to anything, church in Colossae, Philippi? Fellowship. No, that's not what Jesus does. Jesus comes right up alongside of us and says, you know what? You are the man, you are the woman, you are the church that I've called you to be. I have given you a passion, I have given you a purpose, I have given you a platform in this world to be a messenger of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You have a message. You, as a man, a woman, have a message to share. Students, you have a message that needs to be heard. But how do we do that? Through the lens of looking at somebody as they're different than us? Or through the lens of realizing what Jesus Christ has done for us? I want to close with you going on a little field trip with me here. Some of us have had the uncomfortable experience of going through an MRI, right? You lay on a back. There's generally a handful of staff around this tunnel-shaped tube that is eventually going to cover your body or a particular area where they think there may be something wrong. Very uncomfortable. Will you go there with me? Right now in your head, we lay on that almost tanning bed looking object. There's a little hum. You hear some whispers of the medical staff. And then this tube slides right over top of you. And it does some quick little adjustments and makes some sounds and noises. And you're anxious. What are they going to find? Is it gone? How bad is it? How long do I have? Right? When we're in the MRI, and they're saying that it might not be good, but we have to wait for the results. We are having the conversations in our heads. If I wish, I wish I could have done this better. I wish I would have been a better parent. I wish I wouldn't have taken myself so seriously. Wish I could have laughed. Wish I would have been a better friend. Better neighbor. I wish I would have lived. The way God called me to live. The light on the MRI dims down, shuts off, and eventually slides past, and you are now exposed and kind of out of your element because you don't know what the doctor saw. And then you're in a waiting game. 3, 4, 5 days. If it's bad, they tell you relatively quickly. Friends, a spiritual MRI, you don't need to wait for the results. If you ask like David did, search me, O God, and identify, are there any impurities within me? Are there any impurities within my heart, within my mind? And create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Did that happen immediately? Absolutely it did. David, through the help of a friend, brought in light of the Holy Spirit, allowed God to give him an MRI after an extramarital relationship and a murder. But David had the courage to say, yes, Lord, give me an MRI. Create in me a right spirit, O God. Friends, what will your MRI reveal about you? What about your head? What are you thinking about? What do you spend your time thinking and pondering and dreaming up? What about your heart? What about your soul? The promise of David is the same promise for every single one of us here. Clean heart, O God. And renew that spirit in me. Will you do that? Will you be gentle with your spouse solely because you know that Christ has been gentle with you? I'm going to pick on dads. Dads, sometimes we're airheads, right? Are you going to be gentle with your son? Your daughter? Moms, wives, will you be gentle because Christ was gentle with you? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, I pray for your Holy Spirit to continue to work in our lives. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for never, ever giving up on us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you please stand? We talked about Paul. We talked about Coach Boone. We talked to Jesus. But I want to have this benediction land on Jesus and his display of gentleness. Remember Jesus, the one who formed the entire universe. Listen to this demonstration of gentleness. They took Jesus away. Carrying the cross by himself, he went to the place called the skull, or Golgotha. There they nailed him to the cross. Two others were crucified with him, one on either side, with Jesus between them. And Pilate posted a sign over him that read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek so that all people could read it. Then the leading priests objected and said to Pilate, "Change it from the King of the Jews to I am." He said, "I am the King of the Jews," excuse me. Friends, is there a better display of gentleness? Controlled passion. Controlled love. Ready to be used at the time when God says it is time, Jesus, to control your anger, your heart, your love, your commitment, your passion, your desire to serve me. Jesus Christ displayed it for us on the cross. Amen. Amen. Will you please be seated? We will usher you out. Thank you for coming. Stay safe. Have a great week, everyone.
I'm actually going to invite you to stand with us as we sing this, and then at the conclusion of this song, please be seated and let the ushers lead us out. Exalted,
exalted, he is exalted on high, he is exalted, for great. Exalted, he is exalted. Blessing and honor, glory and power unto the Lord be praised. Sing with the chorus resounding before us, holy is his name. His name exalted, he is exalted on high, he is exalted. Exalted, he is exalted. Blessing and honor, glory and power unto the Lord be praised.
God bless you all. Have a wonderful week. Go in His peace.